a creature in the bed. I
see, same room.
Yeah,
all of those should be the same.
Well,
nobody sees it.
No, I'm sitting here. There's a spot in the yard. I'm sitting in the spot. But Law's not here.
And there are a, I'll play it straight the next thing you do. What he wants. He didn't play it. He has a chance to do it.
Bonnie's
even hot. I'll get two more. It's too hot. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you.
Such a disruptor. And then they crawl over the
The Sabbath day. You'll notice a couple things. One is that there is an affirmation of faith that's in the bulletin. We are not going to be using that today. I wrote that up because I think there's some pieces missing from the Apostles' Creed, some things that I thought they ought to include. And so I wrote one that I thought was a fuller statement. But a statement of affirmation of faith is not an individual statement. It's a statement of the community. So I want you to have a chance to read it, to look at it, to make notes on it, to scratch out parts, to add parts, and then you give it back to me and we'll work on this thing together. It gives you something to do during the sermon. So that's a possibility. I also, reminding you, as I'm reminding myself, that it's time to silence your phones so that the podcast can go out. but we have work to do. Let me invite you to stand as we join together in the call to worship. God has spoken to us in words of promise and placed a lighted lamp on our way.
God has granted us wisdom and insight into the mystery of God's will.
Let us explore together what this means for our daily lives and for our church.
We seek to know God's presence through ear and to receive spiritual blessings.
Let's join together in opening prayer.
In our journey through life, we need to know, O God, that we are not alone. We hear your promise to be with us in all of life's ups and downs. And in that assurance, we seek to be your people. Direct us so we can be fully open to your leading as we worship together. Amen.
Our first hymn is number 158. Come Christians, join it to sing. Sense the wonder of who God is, we are moved to admit our unworthiness. Join with me.
We pray from our God to denounce the mistakes of our faith. We have brought us a long way through life. We have doubted your word, denied your love, and violated the promises we have made to you. Lift us out of the narrow circles of self-concern that imprison us in limited vision and flawed wisdom. Confront us with mystery, powerful enough to change us. Amen.
Take a moment, take your individual petitions to God. We are redeemed and forgiven according to God's purpose revealed in Jesus Christ. Amen. We come now to a time of joys and concerns. We lift them up to one another, but we also lift them up to God. Do Do we have any that we want to share this morning?
Yes, Diana called just before church began to say that she was on her way over to Metroplex to see her daughter Sherry, who had a stroke this week. And it's just been one cascade of problems after another. She's now in critical care unit and having a tough time. And so Diana was going to miss us, but she's going to see Sherry, which she needs to do. So let's keep Sherry in our prayers.
Our prayers will go to Sherry and Diana and her family. We sure hope that she's not watching the podcast while she's driving. But we'll lift up our prayers to her and to her daughter. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
On Wednesday, Dad's going to be celebrating a birthday.
You're celebrating one tomorrow.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Lord. Happy birthday.
Over 21 yet?
By a long way.
We have a major concern with our nation. What took place yesterday?
Yes, violence seems to be a theme in our country. We need to pray for that, for the all involved in that shooting yesterday. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
I have praises and a concern. My oldest son, Jesse, got a new job. He had been with the newspaper for almost 22 years, and the newspaper was getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and he's now going to be going to work for the local TV station and College Station, selling advertising for them.
But that's, yay!
So we're really excited about that. Lowell and I get to keep the grandkids this week, but our concern is Wayne Thought, Lowell's oldest cousin, passed away this week, and the funeral's this afternoon at 2 at Nick's graveside, and Lowell's home cooking for it. They're going to have a meal afterwards, so he's cooking beans and cornbread as we speak.
I thought maybe you're resting up for the grandkids.
Yeah, he might be doing that too.
But all right, for your family, for his family, death of that family, and also for new beginnings.
Yes.
It's sometimes hard to change after that many years to do something different, but we hope it goes well. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
And we're happy.
You say the time was 2 o'clock?
2 o'clock at Nick's at the cemetery.
And we're happy that Chrissy's back with us today.
Yeah.
And she's a getting out of the weather.
Yeah.
So Chrissy's back with us. Just in time to play the piano.
Good job.
For all who contribute to the worship, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Any other? Let's take a moment to put ourselves in the presence of God. Lord God, come, be among us now. We need a word of inspiration. We need a word of strength, a word of hope, a word of life, a word of love. Sometimes we lose our way, and we need a way, we need to find a way home. That's why we worship. That's why we pray. We pray for others as much as we pray for ourselves. There are those who are sick and those who are discouraged. Give them light. There are those who are on their way home to you. Give them a warm embrace. We pray for our nation. May we have ears to hear the prophets in our midst. May we turn away from voices that are seeking their own interests. Send us a glimpse of your will, that we might move closer to to you. We pray all this in Jesus' name, using his words when he says,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
The scripture reading today is not the one that's printed in the insert. Something you may not know about the lectionary, they're set scriptures, but they match very well at Easter and Christmas. But in the summertime, they don't always match. Some denominations pick one scripture and some pick the other. And the Amos passage is an alternative that was for this Sunday, and we thought that was better than David dancing. So let's read here about Amos.
Our scripture is Amos chapter 7, verses 7 through 15. This is what the Lord showed me. The Lord was standing by a wall with a plumb line in his hand. The Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? A plumb line, I said. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the middle of my people Israel. I will never again forgive them. The shrines of Isaac will be made desolate, and the holy places of Israel will be laid waste, and I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Israel, reported to Israel's king Jeroboam, Amos has plotted against you within the house of Israel. The land isn't able to cope with everything that he is saying. Amos has said, Jeroboam will die by the sword, and Israel will be forced out of its land. Amaziah said to Amos, you who see these things, go, run away to the land of Judah. Eat your bread there and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's holy place and his royal house. Amos answered Amaziah, I am not a prophet, nor am I a prophet's son, but I am a shepherd and a trimmer of sycamore trees. But the Lord took me from shepherding the flock, and the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel. Now then, hear the Lord's word. You say, don't prophesy against Israel, and don't preach against the house of Isaac. Therefore the Lord proclaims, your wife will become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and your daughters will fall by the sword, and your land will be measured and divided up. You yourself will die in an unclean land, and Israel will surely be taken away from its land. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is Psalm 24, and it's in your insert.
The words to the response are, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And it goes like this. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. Everybody else.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it.
The world and its inhabitants too.
Because God is the one who established it on the seas.
God set it firmly on the waters.
Who can ascend the Lord's mountain?
Who can stand in his holy sanctuary? The earth is the Lord's and everything in it.
Only the one with clean hands and a pure heart.
The one who hasn't made false promises. The one who hasn't sworn dishonestly.
That kind of person receives blessings from the Lord.
And righteousness from the God who saves.
And that's how things are with the generation that seeks him.
That seeks the face of Jacob's God.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it.
Mighty gates, lift up your heads. Ancient doors, rise up high so the glorious king can enter.
Who is the glorious king?
The Lord, strong and powerful. The Lord, powerful in battle.
Mighty gates, lift up your heads. Ancient doors, rise up high. So the glorious king can enter.
Who is this glorious king?
The Lord of heavenly forces. He is the glorious king.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it.
Our next hymn is number 61, Come Down, Almighty King. Let me invite you to stand as you're able. These things because the name of Jesus had become well known. Some were saying John the Baptist had raised up from the dead, and this was why the miraculous powers are on their way through him. Others were saying he is Elijah, telling still others were saying he is the prophet. Is that the right scripture?
Yes.
Okay. But then Herod heard the rumors and said, John, whom I beheaded, has raised to life. He said this because Herod himself had arranged to have John arrested and put in prison because Herodias, the wife of Herod's brother, Philip. Herod had married her, but John told her, Herod, it is against the law for you to marry your brother's wife. So Herodias had it in for John. She wanted to kill him, but she couldn't. This was because Herod respected John. He regarded him as a righteous and holy man, so he protected him. John's words greatly confused Herod, so yet he delighted to listening to him. Finally, the time is right. It was one of Herod's birthdays when he was prepared and prepared a feast for his high-ranking officials and military officers and Galilee's leading residents. Herod's daughter, Herodias, came in and danced, thrilling Herod and his dinner guests. The king said to the woman, "Ask me whatever you wish, and I will give it to you." Then he swore to her, "Whatever you ask, I will give you, even as much as half of my kingdom." She left the banquet hall and said to her mother, "What shall I ask for?" "John the Baptist's head," Herodias replied. Hurrying back to the ruler, she made her request. "I want you to give me John the Baptist's head on a platter, right this minute." Although the king was upset because of his solemn pledge and his guest, he didn't want to refuse her. So he ordered the guard to bring John's head. The guard went to the prison, cut off John's head, and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the young woman, and she gave it to her mother. When John the Baptist's disciples heard what had happened, they came and took the dead body and laid it in the tomb. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Some of you know that I like old things. I've decided especially I will like old things as I become older. Now I'm one of the old things I don't like. But I like old things. I like books. I like old cameras. I like old typewriters, old cars. I had an old car at one time. The problem was that I couldn't keep it running. I am not mechanically inclined. I have to pay somebody else to do it, and that became difficult to do. But I admire people who can restore things. I admire people who can take something that's old, like a car, and fix it up so it runs well, but it also looks good. I've seen cars that were 30, 40 years old that look just as good as when they came off the showroom. I admire people who restore houses. When they take houses that are unlivable and recondition them and make them useful again. For one thing, because the alternative is the trash heap or the bulldozer to get rid of that stuff. I like to preserve it. I like to restore it. I would like to see it restored. Now, I say that because I think Amos is a restorer. He wants to restore the kingdom of Israel. Now, the people looking at him and listening to him didn't see what needed to be restored. The nation was prosperous. Everyone was doing, the people in general were doing well. There was peace among nations. There were no great nations that were threatening Israel. Everything was rosy. Everything was good. But Amos saw with a different set of eyes. What he said, all were people who had forgotten God. With everything going so well, they thought, look what we have done, rather than give God the credit. They no longer worship God. He also saw people who abused and neglected the poor. The rich were doing fine, but they were using their wealth to circumvent the rules, and they were not paying any attention to those who were doing without. So Amos had a word for the people of Israel, a word that's going to be hard the word that's going to be challenging, the words that they're not going to want to hear. He says, I have an image that God has given me of a plumb line. Anybody know what a plumb line is? You probably use one. String with a weight on the end. No batteries. Why does it work? Because gravity works. Gravity always points towards the center of the earth, so the line is always going to be straight. And so God says, I have a straight line that I want to put in the midst of the people to tell if they're straight or not. Now, I imagine that they've used the plumb line to construct walls. Because if a wall wasn't straight when you began it, it's going to be really crooked when you get to the top. And it's not going to stand up. You had to have something to measure it against and say, this is what a straight line is. Now, Amos is talking about not the construction, but the reconstruction of the wall. If you have a wall that's leaning one way or another, things don't tend to stay the same. You put it up against that wall and it measures whether it's upright or not. Now, the only reason to measure is because you want to restore it, because there is a possibility of straightening it up. If you're going to destroy the wall, if you're going to knock it down, there's no reason to measure it. But God says, I have a measuring strength that tells you whether that wall is straight. When was the first time they used the measuring strength? If this is the second time, when is the first time? I think it was in the wilderness when Moses went up on the mountain and received the Ten Commandments. Here is the Word of God. Here is the minimum requirements for living together. This was not imposed on people. This was to make life together in a community possible. This was the nature of life. This was a reflection of what the universe stood for. And here's the straight line. You can't bend it. You can't make it point in a new direction. It is up and down all the time. And anything else that is up and down is not going to match that marker. Now, Amos said that because he saw the wall was leaning. It was not upright. It was not straight. People were not doing the right thing. It was not well received. The priest said, you're a traitor. He goes and tells the king, he's talking against you. He's a traitor. He's a troublemaker. He's stirring up trouble. And you need to do something about it. People who have that challenge, who have the way of life challenge, don't take it very well. Especially when they're doing well. They have something to lose if that changes. He says, you are just trying to make a profit. You're trying to make a living off challenging about saying something negative. Amos said, no, I'm not trying to do that. I didn't choose this job. I had a very good job as a farmer and as a shepherd. I was very content there, but God called me out. I am not a prophet. This is not my living, nor am I the son of a prophet. Now, what that meant was that if your father was something, you had to be that also. So I didn't inherit the job. I didn't seek it, and I didn't inherit. God picked me and told me to tell this word because it's a word of hope. If people listen, they can straighten up that wall and match what God has put down in the center, in their midst. Now, what can we gather from that for this time and place? One thing, I think we learned that the will of God does not change over the years. It is not the product of some fashion. It is not a popular vote. It is not whatever's popular right now. It's what God says it is. And when you don't measure up to that, the wall's going to fall. If you live by something else, if you create something else, some other standard by which to live, The wall cannot stand, the society cannot stand, it will fall. The other thing is that prophets are crazy. They go and talk a word of truth to power, and they usually get stomped on. They don't, you expect somebody who's from the outside who doesn't have a vested interest in the society, in the way the things are going. You do not expect a king or politicians to be prophetic. They have a vested interest in how the thing turns out. They want their own way. They want to make sure that they stay on top. They want to make sure they stay in control. So they have a vested interest. The king cannot be a prophet. The church people cannot be prophets. People who are bishops and leaders in the church have a vested interest in how the church comes out. They can't be prophetic. They cannot challenge the church. They cannot say, this is the way to keep things straight, and we're not going that way. Neither can the wealthy be expected to correct themselves. They have a vested interest in how it comes out. They're doing fine. They don't want to change things. They can't be a prophet. If you want to find a prophet, go among the crazy people. Now, some of them are just crazy, but some of them may have a word from God. The question is, do we have ears to hear what they have to say? Will we look at the plumb line that shows where we're off and where we're right, and be able to renew, make straight again that wall according to God's plumb line? We have a plumb line. It happened years, thousands of years later, but it's called Jesus Christ. That's the plumb line. We have to ask, does it follow Jesus' teaching? Does it increase the love of God? Does it increase the love of neighbor? Does it increase the love for ourselves? Can we hear God's word when it takes an embracing and challenging mode? That's the question of hearing God's prophets. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As we affirm our faith, as we worship together, we affirm our faith. Let us give words to that affirmation with the Apostles' Creed in the back of the hymnal, number 881. Let us stand so we show the world what we stand for.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Father, we stand with you as you stand with us. Help us to receive your word, even if it is sometimes a abrasive, sometimes challenging. May we receive it with joy and out of response give ourselves to you. And this offering is a symbol of that gift. In Christ's name. Struck me as I was reading the Apostles' Creed. It's really kind of nervy of me to suggest another creed besides one that's 2,000 years old, isn't it? But I think there's some places that we need to fill in a little bit, so let's make it ours. We also have a hymn this time that I think that y'all know is How Great Thou Art. You've heard it before. But, well, just a second. I want you to know that this was written in 1953. I am 3 years older than this hymn. Let's sing.
Thank you.
blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing. God goes with us in all that we do and is present wherever we go. Amen. Sing our blessing. Trusting in God and following Jesus. Amen.